Left, I think a tour, right, today, and then this is my last lecture. Then Friday, we'll have a guest lecture, Dr. Josh Vogelstein, who's a faculty member in the department, who study big data brain modeling. So I thought it would be fun for you guys to hear this. So since this is my last lecture, I want to say a few things about the course in general, since I'm a course director. And at the beginning, at the very first lecture, when I come here, I ask you to do me a favor and to do all of you a favor. I repeat that request. That is, at the end of the semester, I don't know, have they done the survey? Have you guys done survey?
They did a midterm
survey. Okay, is there a final survey?
Yeah.
Okay, so when you get a chance to do the survey, I think you will before the final exam. And every year I ask all of you to fill in your comments, and particular ones that your student always give specific comments, what you like, what you don't like, and every year after I gather them, I read each and every word you write, and take that to my heart, and think about what we do next year to do better. And I've been doing this for many years, and by doing so, you will help us to improve this class and help future students in this class to learn better, something more interesting. So please take a few minutes, write what you think, what you like, what you don't like, any suggestion you have, and I will read everything you write and carefully. All right, so I thank you all in advance for doing this. Now, we've had a lot of discussion about among faculty members about the class. I can tell you that in beginning from next year, we'll make some changes. You can tell me, now or later, what you think is good or bad. And as I mentioned to you, over the years, this class, the way we teach the class, we have swing back and forth. I started my faculty position here 1995. I've been teaching this since 1997. It's about 20 years. And early on, we had fewer faculty members. So, I used to teach all the entire sensory system. Then we gradually brought in more and more guest lectures to the where you are now. Okay. And there has been a feedback from students, not only you guys, but people before you, that maybe class is too disorganized. I mentioned to you earlier, as course director, the reason we have structure the way we are now is that to give you a chance to listen to researchers who are doing a front line of work, who are creating a knowledge that will go into a textbook. I think this is for the benefits of all of you as a student here in Hopkins in Biomedical Engineering Department. But at the same time, this might have caused difficulties for some of you students who feel the class is very unorganized. And in some university, class like this would be taught by one professor, many universities in the country, or two, and we have maybe too far. So I've been thinking, in light of all the comments that have been given, and to make some changes in the future year, beginning next year, that perhaps will streamline class a bit more, reduce the number of lectures. We still probably maintain four core lectures and have our classes more connected. So one of the things I have to apologize to all of you is that because we're all active researchers, we take excuse for this. Sometimes we have things we have to take care of outside class. So like this year, I went back to compare the, I had some informal chatting with some students from previous years. And I look at the classes, lectures that I gave in this year versus what I gave in last year, because I saved every class. Last year, my lectures are more connected. I think students feel better. This year, because I was traveling earlier semester, I swapped some stuff. I think that's probably not good. But anyway, so what I'm going to tell you is this information I'm going to pass on to future students. That next year, we'll make a greater effort on behalf of us as faculty members to make our lectures more connected in blocks. I think that's the first thing we should do that I hope you guys understand. And then reduce proper number of guest lectures. I'm kind of on the fence of this because I feel some of guest lectures, given lectures, is very useful to you, very interesting for you to learn. It may not reflect in your exam, But, you know, that's not the most important thing in the world right now. But anyway, so all of you, I hope you chip in your comments, what you like, you don't like, given what we have now. And that will play a role in how we shape the class for the future years, and we continue to involve this. Another question I'm going to ask you, I will take a very quick feedback from you, is that for those of you who are sitting here, how many of you one of you have a concentration as BME, right? How many of you are in a concentration of a neural engineering? What's your concentration?
Computational.
You have a computational, you have tissue engineering, right? What else?
Instrumentation
and?
Imaging.
Systems. So there has been discussion among faculties whether we should. This is a question I just, I'd like to hear from you guys now or later. For class like this, because we have SBE 1, 2, 3, I think we have 4 now, right? 1, 2, 3 is required. So we are actually, it turns out, as based on my survey over years for incoming graduates across the university and country, our program, we are the only BME program in the country that require all of you to learn neuroscience in SBE 2. I have not found any program to do so. We thought this is a very important, useful education for all of you, whether you're gonna be a neuroscientist, a neurosurgeon, or not, right? But do you guys feel, if you don't feel, want to tell me now, write in your comments. For you, who as average BME student, choosing a concentration that's not focused on the brain, is this class useful for your education and knowledge or not? This question has been put on the table in our recent faculty meeting, and it has been proposed, so perhaps we need to divide class like this into small portions where, for example, tissue engineers say, exaggerated. Some tissue engineer would say, well, I'm doing tissue engineering, who cares about the brain and neuroscience? So I'm going to drop this, do something else. Myself, I will tell you, I could be embarrassed, but I'll tell you what I feel. Every year when I go out to give lectures in other universities, outside the country sometimes, or run into former graduate students, every year, without exception, I would run into students who, just like you, took the class a few years earlier, and I completely forgot their face. They'll come to me and say, Dr. Wang, I graduated from BME program. I said, oh. Then I immediately know he or she must have taken the class, because it's required, you cannot graduate without taking it. And they told me how much they like it. And I just ran into one about 2 weeks ago, we have an alumni reunion. And one of our former students graduated about 3 or 4 years ago, and he worked in a startup company in Silicon Valley. And he approached me, told me the exact same thing that I just told you, that he took a class, he thought it was very useful. So from our point of view, for those of us who started brain, and our feeling about the class is such, because brain and the nervous system is something that all of you will deal with, whether it could be neuroscientist, it would be neurosurgeon, you will be pediatrics, you will be engineer, you will be salesman. You're going to sell stock to some people. You need to know something about the brain, because it's hard to make that argument for everything in our body. But for the brain, for the nervous system, for the foreseeable future in your career, this is basic knowledge we believe very strongly you guys should learn and will benefit. However, if many of you feel otherwise, you should let us know, because 10 years from now, 5 years from now, we may not be teaching every BME student in neuroscience. We may not require every BME student to take neuroscience. But that's what really depends on your feedback. So I'm just putting this in here now. And since you have one more year at Hopkins, you still have a chance to give the department the program and feedback. Anyway, so I will say so much. So here is what we stopped last time. And last time we talked about there is a part of a brain, and I illustrated here roughly the position. We call it a pitch center. That is, the neurons here seem to be selectively processing pitch in tonal language in music. And I also said that we have discovered this also in the monkey species. Okay? Now, but pitch is only one aspect of speech music. And also, this region is actually very small. In monkeys, it's only about a millimeter. In humans, only a few millimeters. But the rest of auditory cortex, what do they have? Do they have specific neurons that are selective to things that you often find interesting in music and speech? And here is a spectrogram showing the violin, piece of violin pudding. And what you see here is interesting here is all the harmonics, right? I think most of you, maybe 70-80% of you, by my previous count, that have some formal musical training. I think many of you play instrument, and some of you have a double degree in Peabody. So this will be of interest to you. So this is a spectrogram of violin. You see all the harmonics. Okay. Now, one of the things we have discovered recently, and this is something that about 10 years from now, you read this in the textbook. The pitch is already written in the textbook. That one of the graduate students in my laboratory discovered that some neurons in the auditory cortex are actually very selective to such harmonic combinations. This is very surprising and interesting. So since you have learned quite a bit about neuroscience now, so you can appreciate this. So let me tell you what does a neuron look like. This is called a harmonic temporal neuron that we just published earlier this year. And now this neuron, this auditory neuron in auditory cortex, in primary auditory cortex, A1, if you give a different frequency, pure tone, you can see neuron respond to this frequency a little bit here, because the neuron has a frequency tuning. I've seen it many times now. Now, if we give a neuron two tones, because one tone doesn't drive it, so we put a one tone here, we move another tone. So let's give it one tone here, then move another tone. So at any given time, there are two combinations, right? Some of those combinations are harmonic, some are not. What you can see here, when the second tone frequency, at some point, the neuron responds much stronger. But what's interesting is here. Now we're testing this neuron with many harmonics together. Here is 1, 2, 3, about 10, 12 harmonics here. Right? This is our frequency. And then we gradually, along the dimension, we change the harmonics, the intervals. Now remember the pitch example I gave you earlier. If you were going to call this neuron, the pitch would be intervals between this harmonic. Okay. And so now we test this neuron with all kinds of harmonics here. And what's changing is the fundamental frequency, that is the interval between the two components, right? So this is not a dot raster, this is not a spike, that's stimuli. And the corresponding dot raster is here. So what you can see here, at some point, this neuron really fired with many dots here, here, or here. Now, if you look at exactly what's the stimuli that drive this neuron here, is the here one. So F0 refers to the gap between this, because all of these are multiples of F0, right? So you can see this neuron actually really like the stimuli like this with F0 about 1.05 kilohertz. Okay. So what does it mean? We test all the pattern here. That means this neuron is really strongly selective to this pattern. That means many tones at the same time. Okay. This is really reminiscent of a neuron that would be responsive to all the combination of this with a particular F0. Okay. And this is what we call harmonic temporal neuron. And just to convince you, this neuron is really selective to this harmonic pattern. And we did another test on this. So this is another neuron that is selective to four harmonic combination. So we created four harmonic, 10, 20, 30, 40 kilohertz. They're all harmonics. And neuron responds to about 75 spikes per second. Then we begin to generate the jitter. This component stays the same. And this is not action potential, this is actually a frequency component. So we produce a jitter on each frequency, more and more, more and more, right? So the stimuli, the very first one is perfect. You know, we test about 250 of them. By the time we get to 250, it's pretty random. Okay. So what you see is the neurons are firing, initial very high. When the harmonic complex become inharmonic, firing drops, eventually close to spontaneous. So these kind of examples indicate that there are neurons in auditory system that are selective harmonic combinations. And if you analyze further, the relationship between what a neuron is selective to, the F0, versus the basic frequency, that's the relationship. Okay, so what I mean is the following. I might have gone too fast now. So when we talk about neuron outer nerve, I said it's like a V shape, right? The neuron has the most sensitive frequency. In outer nerve, there's no harmonic selectivity. You can give it one tone, neuron respond. Give it harmonic, it doesn't matter. It only respond here. Here, we're talking about neuron in the cortex. It has some frequency selectivity, but it cares whether they give it is harmonic or inharmonic. Okay, and the relationship between this harmonic selectivity and tone is part of here, and that relationship is a multiple of integers, or fraction of integers. For those of you who have learned music, you know that what does that mean. For music, it was an interval, major intervals, ratio of integers. Okay, and these neurons that we discover, harmonic temporal neuron, they are distributed in the outer cortex. So here is where pitch neuron I talked about last time. This harmonic neuron come from the rest of part of the outer cortex. Okay. What is the meaning of this? Okay. Some of you may wonder, why I bore you with all the so many very technical details. So what I mean is the following. So we have to go back to eventual understand question. I brought up last week that especially for those of you who have interest in music, which most of you do. And question is the following. Why do humans like music? This is one. Second one, why do we feel particular music is beautiful? Okay. Now, you could have learned music, you could have learned a composer, all of that. But you don't need any of this. You can test every human being, give them a piece of music. And some music people or universally think is really beautiful. So where does that beauty come from? Why we feel certain things sound so pleasant to our ear, to our brain? All of this should have a reason in the brain, okay? And those harmonic neurons and the pitch neurons could be constructed by circuits like this, right? Now, what I'm drawing you here is a layout of neuron in primary outer cortex, and the stage before that in the thalamus. And each neuron in thalamus will project to multiple neurons in cortex, and each neuron in cortex would receive inputs from multiple thalamus. Okay, this is the general layout. However, another thing we know, and we may have to talk about too much in this class, is that within the cortex, neurons in the upper layers would receive horizontal long-range connections. Okay, some of those connections could be harmonic dependent. That could form the basis of a neuron to selective harmonics. Okay, all of this work is a beginning. And why is this meaningful to do this work in species other than humans? And here's the argument. Why should we expect animals to have harmonic sensitive neurons? Or basically, why should we expect human brains to have harmonic selectivity? The argument is the following. If you look at what's existing around us, harmonic sounds are ever in our hearing environment. They are produced by vocal apparatus of humans and as animal species by music instrument, and basically as a result of nonlinear characteristics of acoustic generator. And everywhere, basically through our evolution, through our ancestors' environment, we have harmonics everywhere. If you are engineers making sound devices, you would know that is most difficult is to make it a device that only produces pure tone, nothing else. That will be most linear device. If you some of you are a fan, if you are a fan of acoustics, you will know when you pick up the speaker or headphone, any acoustic device, the most crappy device make a lot of harmonics. The best device make only one tone, very harmonics, because it's very difficult to make. Therefore, actually, in a natural environment, when birds sing, when animals howl, when sound bounce off the object, they all have harmonics. So harmonic essentially is a nonlinear product of our environment, it's everywhere. If that's the case, if there's a widespread existence of harmonics in our hearing environment and of that of our ancestors, it is therefore reasonable to expect that it be reflected in the evolution and the development of the outer system of humans and animals. Okay, that's our biological argument. And if you look through evolution, and here's where we are. And the monkeys, actually, just talked to you about the monkeys my laboratory work on, is called marmoset. It's part of New World monkeys in South America. So about 30 million years ago, there's a bifurcation in the primate evolution. This line eventually leads to humans. And there are some monkeys in this line, we call Old World monkeys. These monkeys now you find in Asia, in Africa. And this is monkeys that if you go to the zoo, and that you find out. And when I was a kid, I grew up in China. I grew up in a province called Sichuan province. All of you know panda, right? That's where panda come from my province. But I have to tell you this story I always found to tell students. So when my kids was born here, when they were old enough, I took them to Washington Zoo to see panda. The panda was like a queen. It was so many kids, so many people, so hot. Pile up in a panda place in Washington, D.C. Have you guys seen panda in Washington, D.C.? Oh, you should go see it. It's such a star. So when I told my kids, when I grew up in my hometown, we have a zoo. We have a lot of pandas. When we were the kids, when we go to a zoo, nobody paid attention to panda. Where do we go? We wanted to see monkeys. So there's a big zoo, a big place with monkeys. The monkeys are not individual. There are mountains. There are about 2,000 or 3,000 monkeys play around joyfully, and you are allowed to buy peanuts there and feed them. Monkey would jump in the air, you threw peanuts, and as kids, it was so fun, far more fun than panda. So when I took my kids to Washington Zoo, boy, everyone treated panda as a queen. That would call me when I grew up in my college and in my hometown. Panda just walking there eating bamboo. This is normal. I was not a big star anyway. But the monkeys I saw when I was a kid, and if you go to most of the zoo, when people say monkey, come from this category called older monkeys. Okay, the monkey my lab working on is here, the new world monkeys. So it's about 30 million years ago, they bifurcate. Now, I just told you last 2 days ago that we discovered the neuron to encode the pitch in these monkeys, right? Now, I said everything about how important pitch is for music and speech, and that's all here. So what does that mean? That means either before this bifurcation point, the brain that evolved to all of this here already have neurons that process a pitch, or in last 25 million years, that there's a parallel evolution, that these monkeys evolved into pitch, so do other species like humans. Okay. So all of that interesting to our understanding of origin of music perhaps, because we said last time, if you look at the evolution history, music is with us, has been with us only a few hundred years, and this is millions of years. So in order to understand the question that I raised earlier, why we humans want to listen to music, why music sounds, certain music sounds pleasant to our ears, you have to look into this through evolution biologically. That's the point I want to make. Okay. Now, this is the reference I want to give to you. There was one more thing I want to say. At the end of last classes, a couple of students asked me a question that I thought was very intriguing, and that is about absolute pitch. And since I talked about pitch, I just want to mention this very quickly. Our laboratory has been studying to quantitatively measure the accuracy of absolute pitch. How many of you have never heard about absolute pitch? How many have heard about absolute pitch? Great, thank you. So this is basic definition. This is pitch. This refers to a phenomenon. Someone can actually identify identify the notes without reference. Okay. So we were interested in, to know how accurate this is. When you say we can identify pitch, absolutely how accurate it is. So this is some data. It has not been published. I just want to share with you. This is one advantage I feel that when we teach, someone like me to teach it, I can tell you what's going on that you are probably not going to hear for about 10 years. But here's the experiment we do. So we got a subject. We basically play them in this. There are many tests. This is one of the simplest tests. We play a song out of the piano keyboard in this range randomly. Then we ask a person, which one is? Okay, which one is? Now, this is a subject. It's a violinist who has absolute pitch. Here's a stimuli we play. There are 30 of them out of a piano keyboard in this range. There's one semitone apart, so it's fairly distinguishable. We give them a random one here, say which one is. They push a key on a computer. And this is a response. You can see they're almost perfect, right? So this individual has probably really absolute pitch. Then we did more tests. We now divided into even smaller, you know, half semitone, 20 cents so far song. Then you can see the noise here. Not ours, eventually narrow down how close. But I just want to show you at this level, one semitone, a violinist with a perfect pitch will do this. Now guess what? This is a pianist who doesn't have a perfect pitch, but it's, you know, professional trained. Here's what what the subject did. And you see, the subject consistently overly estimate the stimulus on this direction. Okay, you see some error now. Okay, now what about average people? I'm just an average person. I have no musical training. Here's average person. So the same test we give to non-musician, you see all over the places. Yeah. Anyway, so study like this eventually will lead us to nail down what is really absolute pitch and other things. So if you are interested in participating in this study, either as a researcher or subject, please contact Dr. Huang, who is researching in my lab, and we have a laboratory here in Clark. This is where your TA, UHE work and meet with them. That's my lab. So basically, these four subjects, there's another subject who plays traditional Chinese instrument I didn't show here. So these are subjects we test in Beijing in collaboration with Central Conservatory of Music in China. China's a version of Juilliard. So we're doing there, then we use the same paradigm to test the people here, average student from Hopkins, and musically talented student from Peabody, so forth and so on. So we have two pools of a student across the cultural background. I think it'll be interesting by the time we finish this. Okay, so that's for the this one. So let me move on to about the next one part. Okay, so the remaining of the class, I'm going to walk you through, since I want to have about 25 minutes. So the last part of the audio lecture I want to give you, to talk about this part of hearing that you don't often hear. I said beginning, hearing is not a passive, right? So when I make a speech now, when I give a lecture, I hear myself. And that's not trivial. Okay, I hear myself, that's trivial. And what's got involved in this? So today, we're going to cover the last subject. How does the auditory system process speech? Okay. Now, in general, here's what our system has to accomplish. These are questions. Now, we would like to know, when you hear a sound, you would like to know where the sound comes from. That's a processing from space. We talked about last time. And what does it mean? And we said many things about it. This is speech or music. And there's one last thing that you don't often talk about. It's who is talking. Okay. Now, think about this. If I turn off all the lights, I put myself behind a curtain, is me talking or not? Right? Not really. These days, I can put a computer here and talking. And now, some of you are too young. You don't know this yet. But ask older people. People sitting there, suddenly hear someone talk to them. That's called hallucination. But how do you know if someone talk to you inside your head, outside your head? Right? This is actually not a trivial question. But some of the answer can be found in a study of the interaction of the auditory cortex here and the frontal cortex here. Most of the time, in my lectures, we cover here. But I just want to leave this open to you that when we hear sound, we actually involve other parts of the cortex. So that's when you hear something that many times you form a memory, that memory perhaps stored somewhere here. Then when you hear something very familiar, you hear half a word, then you immediately know the whole word. There's a memory retrieval. Okay. And likewise, when you talk, the part of your brain that controls talking or also modulated here. That's which we're going to cover here. Okay. And we said last time, the way pitch is generated is by voice comes through here. And then, because your upper laryngeal space can be configured into different structures, depending where you put your mouth and tongue. So this serves as a filter. Together, air through vocal fold and a filter by here give you vowel. That example I use many times. And this is a architecture for that. And here's the vowel, where the vowel come from. I just want to finish this before I move on to the next one. That is, when I show you a vowel, like it has this form, right? It has a formants, it has a pitch. A pitch comes from glottal pulses going through vocal fold. So that gives you a pitch vibration. The formant comes from a vocal tract. A vocal tract here serves as a filter. A two are filter in series. So this is something you need to see, and you have to write the book with the machine.